That you would like to share, or maybe you have a question about the Bible. Here's an opportunity for you to share your request or get biblical answers. Stay tuned for a live call-in program entitled Prayer and Answers.
Good afternoon. Welcome to another edition of Prayer and Answers. Even though it is very windy outside, I'm hoping that you're having a marvelous Saturday and all is well with your soul today. My name is Randy Smith, and once again, I have the privilege of being the host of this weekly live radio call-in talk show we call Prayer and Answers. This afternoon, my co-host, who's normally flying with me, is not here. Steve had surgery. All is going well with him, but he's taken some time to recover, and hopefully he'll be back next Saturday. But in his place, I have someone that I met a couple of weeks ago, and I'm enjoying this new friendship with him. This is Pastor Hector Aguilar from First Baptist Church in Anthony, New Mexico. And Hector, welcome to the show, and how are you today?
I'm doing good. Thank you, Randy. It's a pleasure to be here.
All right. Well, let me just explain something to our listeners here. I want you to be kind and patient. Hector has never been on in a radio studio before, and so he said, I don't know why I'm nervous. I preach all the time, and so, but
thank
it's a different thing. Yeah. So I want you all to do us a favor. Would you call in with your prayer request today so that Hector and I can pray with you about what your concerns are. The Bible says, the Lord says, that he wants us to cast all of our cares upon him, and he also tells us that we're to present all of our requests to him, no matter what they are, and he loves the fact that we are a household, which means there's no solo, there's no only children in the household of God, but we are all children in his household, and so we carry one another's burdens, we share with one another. Would you call in with any prayer requests that you have as we pray together over whatever the Lord, whatever challenges are in your life, it ministers to the entire body. Or perhaps you have a Bible question. You might even, I'm hoping that you were in the Word today and that you bumped into something and said, huh, I don't get that. Does that ever happen to you, Hector, where you hit a verse and you go, Lord, you're going to have to explain this to me? Does that?
Yes, all the time.
For me, too. I mean, almost every time I open the Word, I'm like, oh, Lord, I'm not sure I'm getting that right. And how does that match up with this? And so Hector and I have been in the Word for many, many years. And maybe he's given us some answers that we might be able to help you with. So the phone number here is 915-779-0016. And I'm going to talk to Hector for just a moment, just kind of so that you all can get to know him. And I don't want you to be listening, and so you're not dialing. We want you to call in and be a part of the program. In fact, I know that it can be a little, maybe you feel a little bit nervous also, but if Hector's sitting here and doing it anyway, you can too. So the phone number again, 915-779-0016. All right. So Hector, I introduced you as the pastor of First Baptist Church in Anthony, New Mexico. How long have you been pastoring there?
We have been there for about 2 months.
Okay. How's it going?
It's going pretty well. It's good. Going pretty well. Our congregation is very loving, very accepting of me and my family.
Mm,
and,
good.
The Lord is definitely starting to work there.
Oh, wonderful. I want to share something with you.
Sure.
I have gone to some pastors' meetings here in town in El Paso, and most of the churches, the pastors that were there, are from churches that are a little bit larger than yours. And a little bit wealthier than yours, and you're pastoring a small church in a rural area or semi-rural area, and I always leave feeling a little bit hungry, and I was over at your church earlier this week, mm-hmm. and stepped into a pastor's prayer meeting.
Yes.
And it was pastors from little churches all around that area. And the Spirit of God was there, and I walked away satisfied. So well done, brother. You're doing good.
Praise the Lord. Yeah. Praise the Lord.
Well, let's go to our telephone lines. Good afternoon, Beverly. Welcome to Prayer and Answers.
Thank you, Randy. I appreciate that.
What's on your mind today?
Well, I was talking to my daughter, Texie, and I was reading her this verse, and I said, "Now, what do you think that means?" And she said, "Call in and ask Randy."
Well, that'll bless that'll be a blessing to everybody instead of just you and your daughter.
Okay, I think maybe I kind of know, but there's just something how you know sometimes you'll read something and it kind of nags at you.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Because you're not sure if you totally get it.
Okay.
So this is in Luke 13:24. And as I'm reading it, I'm thinking about knock, seek, you will find. You know, all these things that are in the Bible that if we seek. But this verse says, strive to enter through the narrow door. For many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able. So I think that I tell you, many will seek to enter and not be able.
Hmm. Well, Beverly, there are many answers to that. There's sermon after sermon on this one verse that we could preach. I cannot answer fully with everything, but I will give you a few things to think about, okay? But before I do that, first I want to ask you, so were you reading your Bible and bumped into this, or did you hear it from some pastor on...
No, okay. I was reading it.
So do you normally?
For some reason, I don't know if it was a devotional or what, but it's kind of been hanging in my mind for the last, like, okay, I read this, you know, that God says if we seek with our whole heart, we will find Him, and it just kind of like a nagging, like I don't understand what that means.
Okay, well, I just want to pursue this a little bit further, Beverly, while I got you on the line. So you were reading your Bible. Do you do that regularly?
I do, and I try.
Well, good.
I won't say every day, but mostly every day.
Oh, that's wonderful. All right. Do you like doing it, or is it a burden?
You know, it's not anymore.
Yeah.
I won't say that at one time I think it was.
Yeah.
And because I would be trying to follow a program.
Oh, yeah.
Skip a few days, and I'd just read to read words.
Yeah, yeah.
I wasn't reading to get meaning and to really ponder and think about it.
Well, so I'll share with you that normally I would read a program year after year. The first time I read through the Bible, I was very young. I was about 13 and read all the way through it. And I just developed a desire to learn. But these days, Beverly, I threw the program away this year, and I'm going very slowly, and it's more like this is my breakfast, this is my daily bread.
Yes.
And I was telling my wife this morning, my God is a great cook. I was just sitting there reading the Word and just being mesmerized, awestruck, satisfied, filled with joy at the things that He has written. I actually told her, I said, I kind of feel like the Holy Spirit is here and saying, I'm really happy that you like what I wrote. You know, that He's the author, and I'm reading what He wrote.
Don't you know that must give Him great joy?
Yeah, so as far as the answer to your question, I'm going to spend a couple of minutes with it, and then I'm going to turn it over to Hector and see what's on his mind. But I do want to share with you, evidently, I had written a couple of notes next to this verse for a sermon, and my notes are still here. So I first of all want to read these notes, and then this is one side of the story, and then I'll go to the other side. John chapter 6, verse 40 says this, "For this is the will of my Father, that everyone looks on the Son and believes in Him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day." And Romans 10:13 says, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." So I don't want you to get the impression that God has made a door narrow because He doesn't want very many people to come in. Do you get that?
I do.
He wants everyone to come in. He wants everyone to come and be saved. However, it's also difficult, and there's not a thousand ways to come. There is only one way, and in fact, the door is Jesus Christ himself. He is the door. And what happens is when a person is confronted with that, when they come face to face through the Holy Spirit with this, they have to make a decision. The Bible says that you have to confess on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved. What happens is there's a submission that takes place, and very few will do it. Beverly, you've been listening for a long time. Do you remember Pastor Jay that used to do this show with me?
I absolutely do.
He said that one of the verses that always haunted him was when Jesus said, on that day many will say, Lord, Lord.
Yes.
And I will say, I never knew you.
Yes.
All right, so let us go back one verse before the verse that you read, verse 23. And someone said to him, Lord, will those who are saved be few? And he said to them, strive to enter through the narrow gate, for many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able to. Let me ask you to answer this question from verse 23. Lord, will those who are saved be few? What do you think the answer is?
Yes.
Yes, it's a remnant. And that's very sad, because any who will may come, but it's a very narrow door. And it is sad, isn't it?
So are they not seeking enough?
No, it's just like what he said about the rich man. He said it's difficult, rich man.
That's true.
It's what happens, Beverly, is a person has to come to the place. Here's kind of a formula. One, they have to come to the place where they recognize and confess really deep in their hearts that they actually do have a sin problem. Well, that knocks out over half of humanity right there, won't even admit. I remember Donald Trump was saying, no, I never say to God, I'm sorry, I just try to do better. I mean, in our carnality, we have to admit, I have a problem, and the problem is my sin. And then the second thing we have to admit is this: there is no solution except for me to come as a beggar to Jesus Christ, and it takes some humility. In the book of Isaiah, God speaks, and he says, I live in a high and lofty place, but also with him who is of a contrite and lowly heart. Well, that knocks out another, 30% of humanity.
That's true.
And then when you do come, you have to confess him as Lord, as well as confessing your sins. In other words, you have to say, you are the king, and I am the servant, and I give my life now. It's a repentance, as you saw a few Sundays ago. It's a complete turning from one direction to another. Okay? And that's why few. Hector, you want to talk about this a little bit?
Hi, Beverly. How are you?
I'm good, Hector. It's nice to hear you on the phone, on the radio, because we've been praying for you.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much for calling in. One of the things that I like to do when I am looking at a verse, I'm looking at the NLT right now, and I'm a big, I love context. When I look at a verse, I'm always looking at what's going on and what is the word telling me before the verse I'm looking at and after. And it's a good thing that y'all brought up verse 23, where it says, the NLT says, someone asked him, Lord, will only a few be saved? Of course, he replied, work hard to enter the narrow door to God's kingdom, for many will try to enter but will fail. But then you keep going down, and it says, when the master of the house has locked the door, it will be too late.
Oh,
he will stand outside knocking and pleading, Lord, open the door for us. But he will reply, I don't know you or where you come from. Then you will say, but we ate and drank with you, and you taught in our streets. And he will reply, I tell you, I don't know you or where you come from. Get away from me, all you who do evil. Now, those last verses, 26 and 27, are very, very haunting. Basically, the Lord is telling them, I don't know you. I've never known you. Now, we know that the Lord knows everyone, but here he talks about there's going to be a time where the house will be locked and it will be too late, and nobody will be able to enter into the house, and people are going to be outside knocking, Lord, let us in. Did we not do these things? Did we not eat and drink with you? Did we not teach in the streets? And so basically I think what he is saying, it's coming down to an issue of works. Even pastors, I've known many pastors that have preached and have done good things and have grown to churches, but they don't really have Jesus in their heart. And I think it's very important to understand that it doesn't matter what we do or what we say or where we go in the name of Jesus. We can serve in churches, we can go to church every Sunday, we could even read our Bibles, but that doesn't mean that we might have an intimate and personal relationship with our Lord. And so with that in mind, I go back up to verse 24, and it speaks of the narrow door. Unfortunately, not everybody is going to be saved, and that's a hard truth to swallow. Only few are going to actually be saved, because it tells us here the narrow door. Now, in saying that, going back to what Randy said, you know, the Lord wishes for all of us to be saved. He doesn't wish for anybody to not be saved. He wants everyone to accept him and to accept his son. But the road to heaven is a narrow one, and not everyone will be able to enter it. I remember going back to the account of Noah when his family entered into the ark, and they were the only ones, and everybody else perished. And so that's what I see from here. The good news is that God wants everyone saved. And right now, in this present time, heaven's door is wide open. God's arms are wide open, and he's welcoming, he's inviting souls, and he's inviting people, and he's telling people every day, come to me. I am meek and I am humble. Come to me right now while you still have a chance. So the good news about this is that the invitation to salvation is wide open right now.
And, Beverly.
Absolutely. Thank you. So, I think that has. I think I get it.
And Beverly, can you hear me right now?
I can.
Okay, I couldn't hear myself. Hey, the one of the things that as we were talking, it breaks my heart how many are going to be lost. And yet, I know that Franklin Graham
is coming in. Thank you, Kenny. Franklin Graham is coming in March, and he's going to present the gospel, and there'll be, you know, I don't know, 4,000 or 5,000 people there. Would you pray about that, Beverly? Would you ask God's blessing upon it?
I will.
Thank you.
Lord Jesus, we know that during this crusade, and it's just really a crusade, dear Lord, that many will hear, maybe for the first time, in a language that they understand, that invitation for them to come. And to know, dear Lord, as they go, dear Lord, that absolutely, once they choose that road, they're on a road they cannot get off of. That we just pray that the Lord would just give them the hunger to know him in that really personal way. Not just in this arbitrary, I know who Jesus is, and I've said the sinner's prayer. We pray, Lord Jesus, that this will touch the hearts. This will absolutely touch the hearts. And, Lord Jesus, this will change El Paso. This can change El Paso. So we come to you with sorrow, we come to you with joy because of what we know is going to happen. And dear Lord, we just pray for those that do not choose now to seek God and to know who he is. We just ask only you, Lord Jesus, only you can draw people to yourself. So, Lord Jesus, we just pray many are drawn and many will come who seek you with their whole heart, mind, and soul. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen, Beverly, and thank you so much for calling. Bye-bye.
Yes. Okay, bye-bye.
Good afternoon. Is this Minerva? Hello?
Pastor.
Yes, go ahead, Minerva.
Okay, I'm sorry, I have a bad signal. Let me know when you can't hear me.
We can hear you good.
Okay, a quick question and a prayer request. The question is, I'm sitting here looking at a plastic thing for your window with the nativity scene. Mm-hmm. And why do they put around Mary and Joseph that circle like an aura?
Halo. Yeah, it's a halo. Yeah.
Why?
All right, so originally, whether from Eastern Orthodox or from Roman Catholic, it was to signify that they are saints. And in Roman Catholicism, a person is declared a saint by the church when there's evidence of a certain amount of good deeds as well as a miracle.
Right.
And the Catholic Church, Roman Catholic Church, will then signify that this person is a saint. Their deeds are so good that they have actually stored up some extra benefits in this treasure chest that the Pope has access to. And so it's signifying that they are saints. Now, the truth of the matter is anyone who has come to Christ as a sinner and asked for forgiveness of sins and accepted his sacrifice on the cross as a substitute for them and has received Jesus as their Lord and has been born again and is a new creation and is filled with the Holy Spirit, every one of them by scriptures is called saint. And it's not the Roman Catholic Church that determines our sainthood, but it's our position in salvation with Christ. Now, having said that, Minerva, we are supposed to be emanating and being a fragrance of God and being image bearers of God now. And people should be able to sense what you're seeing there in the picture of that halo around them. They should, your life should be such a life that there's a bit of a glow about you. Now, most of them will yell at you and scream and throw rocks at you trying to put out the light.
Right.
So don't think that that's going to mean that you're not going to be persecuted. But you, Minerva, you have that light in you. Did you know that?
You know what, Pastor Randy? That happened to me one time with a customer at the post office. Mm. I offered my tape and I was had just started going to the church I go to, and you always preach, I love the sermons. And so when she said that to me, she said, "Oh my gosh, there's something about you and about the way you are." I was humbled.
Yeah.
I was humbled, and I thought, really?
Yeah.
But you're right, we give fruit the way we act, you know, we're supposed to act like God expects us. Jesus wants us, you know, to emanate him in us.
Yeah.
Be godly.
And the Bible says that we are the aroma of Christ. To those who are being saved, it's a pretty good aroma. To those who are being lost,
Amen.
It's the smell of a funeral home. It's the fragrance of death. So, Minerva, real quickly, say hi to Hector, and then Hector, if you want to expound eloquently on this, it's good.
Hi, Minerva. How are you?
Hi. Good, good. And you?
I'm doing good. Well, thank you so much for calling in. I think pretty much Randy said everything there is to say. When the Holy Spirit is in us, people will notice that. And to a certain extent, it might make people feel somewhat uncomfortable, especially if they don't know the Lord. But it's during those opportunities where we get a chance as believers to tell others about Jesus and maybe expound on something that's going on in their hearts or in their minds. And, we're always too speak of the hope that we have in us. And so those are the opportunities that we can use to speak of God, and especially right now during the holiday season when we got, there is like a nativity all over the place. I mean, there's not one place where you drive and there's a nativity scene of some sort. You see them all over TV, and it's a beautiful opportunity during the Christmas season to be a light and to be a witness to people and to tell them about Jesus and the hope that you have inside of you.
Pastor, there is, this is from what I understand, the holidays, Christmas, is the highest rate of suicide and for people. And I think that we should, I think a lot of us sometimes, I used to be that way, I was very scared of somebody not accepting if I wanted to speak to somebody about Jesus. And I remember reading that if we're embarrassed of him, he will be embarrassed of us. And so I prayed. I said, you put people in my path and I'll minister to them. I know you will give me the words. And boy, did that ever happen. So much so that the first day I said that, it happened twice. And I had to go to the restroom. And I was crying because what they were sharing. And I joked, which I know you don't joke, but I mean, I said it. Like I said, oh goodness gracious, I said, God, can you please like go a little slower, because I mean emotionally I'm he gives it, but he puts people in our path.
So Minerva, since you've had that on your heart, I'm going to give you an opportunity to minister right now. Are you ready?
Yes.
I have a dear friend named Charles, and he's also a listener to this radio show, and he's just been doing, the Lord and him have just been on this amazing, wonderful journey for months, and his life has just been so filled with joy and gratitude and excitement and enthusiasm. And he's about our age, Minerva. And he was down this beautiful church fellowship that he was going to go to. He lives, you know, he just wanted to fellowship with some believers and he was going to go to their Thanksgiving dinner. And he became ill and hospitalized, and he missed that. And now he's released from the hospital, but he's home alone. And he's really hoping that he won't miss their Christmas fellowship. And so, but he's very ill. And it's a trial, being ill and being bedridden and all that goes with that. So, Minerva, would you please pray for Charles right now?
Yes.
All right.
Dear Lord, we come to you and pray for Charles, for his health, that he will get better, but also that there will be fellowship coming to his home, making it available for him.
Amen.
To enjoy the fellowship, because there are some of us who maybe feel awkward sometimes, but when we want fellowship, that we find a church that is welcoming, because even people who are lost, if they come to a welcoming church, it can change their life. And so I hope and I pray that they will, believers who know about Charles will visit him and give him that fellowship that we will need. And I pray for yourself, and I pray that during this season that you will be with him and comfort him and cover him in your blood and protect him from anything that may try to harm him, and that he has peace during this season and all year long. In your name, amen.
Okay, Minerva. Amen. Now, Minerva, I'm going to give you a homework assignment. I'm going to ask you to pray for Charles every day.
I will.
And just keep lifting him up in prayer until I can report to you that the Lord has done well with him. He's healthy. He has found fellowship, and all is well. Okay?
Yes, sir. And I did have a prayer request.
All right, go ahead.
Okay, so my prayer request is, everything has been coming at me. Not everything. I mean, I'm in trouble in my car and trouble at work with my disability and everything. And so my question, I need prayer because I do have, I don't know if you guys have seen the commercial, I'm using warranty companies. I have endurance, and they don't pay everything all the time. Mm. So I'm looking at my car. If it doesn't cover it, I've had so much trouble with it. I'm going to have to give it back to the bank and say, hey, here it is, because I can't continue with it. My prayer is that endurance will cover it. I've been praying, and I want to thank my brothers and sisters in church. I put myself on the prayer list, and they are such wonderful saints. And they text me, and they're praying, and everything. I'm just grateful. I find prayer for that, for the car.
All right.
Church situation, I'll keep the work situation. I'm praying.
Work in your car, yeah.
Car more than anything, yes, please.
All right. So, Hector, would you mind taking these prayer requests to the Father with us?
Sure, it would be my honor. Dear Lord Jesus, we are so thankful to be here today, Father God, thankful for your fellowship, for your grace, for your mercy. Lord, we know that you are here with us present. Father, we just want to lift up Minerva to you, especially during this holiday season. Father God, we want to lift up this issue, most specifically with her car insurance. Lord, we just pray that you intervene in this situation, Lord Jesus. We pray that you intervene in a miraculous way, Father God, like only you can, Lord, that you will go into those places, Lord, and that you will just bring everything together with this insurance and with Minerva's car, Lord Jesus. Let everything work out for your glory, Lord. I know she loves you, Father. She's trusting in you, Lord Jesus, and she is waiting, Father. And so, Lord, we pray in anticipation, Lord, that you will work in this area with her insurance, Lord Jesus. And Father, for all the other issues and problems, Father, that might be going on in her life, Lord, we lift those things up to you, Father God. It can be difficult, especially right now, Lord, during the holidays where you know, we look around and there's people cheerful and there's lights and there's decorations. But as humans, Lord, we hurt and there's things going on in our lives, Father God, that we need to bring to you, Lord. And so, Father, I pray for these things for Minerva, Lord Jesus, that you speak to her heart, that you wrap your arms around her, Lord Jesus, that you let her know that you are with her, that you let her sense your presence, Father, and your mercy and your compassion, Father God, and that you will intervene in this issue with her car insurance, Lord Jesus, and that you will be glorified, Father God. And Lord, just when you are still a miracle working God, Lord, you are still able to do what you have done thousands of years ago and what your word says, Lord Jesus. So we just pray for her right now, Father, that you engage her and that you intervene in this situation, Lord Jesus. Father, we pray always in the Son of your name, Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank amen. You, Minerva.
Thank you.
God bless. Bye.
God bless you. Bye-bye.
Kenny, are we too late? Can we still take a top of the hour break? All right, let me give the phone numbers again. It's 915-779-0016. We're here for any prayer requests you have or any questions, biblical questions. And we'll be back in just a moment with more prayer and answers.
With a Christmas treasure for December 9th, here's Adrian Rogers.
As you rejoice in this Christmas season, celebrate the constancy of the light that shined into the world when Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary. John tells us Jesus was with God in the beginning. Jesus is the eternal God. The wonderful news for you today is that God cannot change. James made this wonderful statement. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Soon we'll welcome a new year, and though our world is a very uncertain place, we have this certainty to lean on. His compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Praise God for the changeless, constant light of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Experience Christmas this year with A Family Christmas Treasury from Adrian Rogers. Request your free copy today at lwf.org/radio.
One's imagination is kindled thinking about the conversation of the innkeeper and his family. Did anyone mention the arrival of the young couple the night before? Did anyone ask about the pregnancy of the girl on the donkey? The innkeeper and his family were so busy. The day was upon them. The day's bread had to be made. The morning's chores had to be done. There was too much to do to imagine that the impossible had occurred. God had entered the world as a baby. Meanwhile, the city hummed. Merchants were unaware that God had visited their planet. The innkeeper would never believe that he had just sent God out into the cold. Those who missed His Majesty's arrival missed it, not because of evil acts or malice. No, they missed it simply because they weren't looking. Not much has changed in the last 2,000 years, has it? In this day of Advent, this is Max Lucado.
This is John MacArthur welcoming you to Portraits of Grace. As a Christian, you are a storehouse of divine love. In addition, you have the privilege and responsibility of demonstrating God's love to others. That's a sacred trust. And that's why the Apostle Paul tells us that godly love must never operate in a vacuum or indiscriminately. It must always be governed by biblical knowledge and spiritual discernment. Unfortunately, today it's common for Christians to compromise doctrinal purity in the name of love and unity, or to brand as unloving some practices that Scripture clearly commands. But no matter how loving our actions might seem, if they violate Scripture, they aren't truly loving at all. So make sure you love biblically. This is John MacArthur, hoping you'll join me again for Portraits of Grace.
And we are back with more prayer and answers. Once again, the phone number here, 915-779-0016. If you're just now tuning in and wondering what's going on, well, this is not your normal preaching and teaching hour that you would normally catch on KELP. This is an interactive live call and talk show that you'll also not hear us ask for an offering. we're just here taking prayer requests and questions on the Bible. So again, 915-779-0016. And particularly if you're listening out in that Anthony area, I would love to hear from you. I know it'd be an encouragement to our guest here today, since he's ministering out there. So you give us a call, please, if you're in the New Mexico area. We've not done this a long time. KELP, you can hear us on 1590, and if that's a weak signal, there's an FM signal of 95.9. And if you're in the New Mexico area and you're having trouble hearing us on one of those, there's 89.3. And then, of course, you can always live stream us at the KELP website. And I think that's at kelpradio.org. Is that where it is? That the website? Yeah. And you can go there, and there's a little button that says live stream. You push the button, and magically, right there too, through your telephone, you'll hear our voices coming through. And that, of course, is the best signal. And so we invite you to listen in those ways. And I also want to appeal to our listeners for a moment. I have a prayer request for myself personally that I would like somebody to call in that would be willing to pray for me. And so, but yes, pastors sometimes, like every day, have problems, and they're Amen. Supposed to handle them in prayer, and they're supposed to share those prayer requests just like we're asking you to share your prayer request with us pastors. So I have a prayer request, and I need somebody to call in so that they can pray for me. Meanwhile, I have a question that came in off of the air, and I have a feeling just the way that the question is presented here, I think I know who this is that called in, and you've done this before, trying to stay below the radar and off of the air, and you don't want to come on the air with us. And I handle your questions off the air, but I would much rather hear from you, Gay, than you just give your question off the air. I'm pretty sure this is from you. So here is the question. It says, we are created in God's image. Is that spiritual or physical? Okay, so this comes from Genesis chapter 1, where, first of all, God says, let us create man in our image after our likeness. And then right after that, it says, so God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. And there's a great deal of discussion that's taken place through the ages about this. Some have said that, well, this question in particular is saying, is that physical or is it spiritual? And Jesus taught us that God is spirit. And so the idea being that he would not have arms and legs like we do, but the word became flesh, and then he became a man also. And so there suddenly we have that now God has flesh just like us. Some have said that it's the following verses where it says, let him have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the earth. And so that it's an issue of dominion, that's where the image of God is. Some have said it's because animals do not have a soul and humans do. These are all some of the different answers that have been given. Now, I tell you that I was talking to my wife yesterday, and I even read her an excerpt from Augustine's Confessions, chapter 10. And I don't have a modern translation of that with me. All I have is Elizabethan English on that. I just want to read you a couple of things in Augustine's Confessions to God. And remember that Augustine had been searching for God, and the reason why he couldn't accept God, the concept of God, was the issue of the physical versus the spiritual. And it took him like 15 years before God brought him to a place where he could understand this issue of physical and spiritual. But I want to just read a few words and then tell you what struck me in this. Augustine is saying that as he was seeking God and he finally saw who God was. Anyway, let me just read a little bit because it's so beautiful. And what is this? I asked the earth and it's answered me, I am not he. And whatsoever are in it confess the same. I asked the sea and the deeps and the living creeping things and they answered, we are not thy God. Seek above us. I asked the moving air. And the whole air with its inhabitants answered, Anaximenes was deceived. I am not God. Just a pause there. Anaximenes was a Greek philosopher who believed that the air was the quintessential element. So Augustine is saying, I asked the air, and the air says, I'm not God. I asked the heavens, sun, moon, stars. Nor say they, are we the God whom thou seekest? And I replied unto all these things which encompass the door of my flesh. Ye have told me of my God that ye are not he. Tell me something of him. And they cried out with a loud voice, he made us. Wow. Creation, the Bible says, cries out day by day, night by night about God. Augustine speaks of asking the animals, and the animals also saying to him, we are not God. Remember in idolatry that they worshiped the created rather than the creator. And I look at the difference between man and animals in this passage of Scripture, and what I realize is this. Only man can look for God. Only man. The animals never look at creation and say, hey, I wonder if somebody made this. They just look at creation and go, where's my next meal? But with us, there is something inside of us that is far beyond what animals are. There is something in us, something profound and beautiful, something huge inside of us, bigger than the suns, bigger than the galaxies. There is something about man. He is of such an infinite value that God would send his only son to die to reconcile mankind to him. And whatever that thing is that's inside of us, whatever that is the image of God. We are his image bearers. And so as I was reading Augustine, I was just looking at this and reflecting on what is so different from us. If you want to know what the image of God is, friends, look inside yourself. And you'll start to see there is something about a human. This is why abortion is such an atrocity. It's a horrible thing because there is something of intrinsic value in each human being far beyond anything that any animal can have. And that intrinsic value that is we can't put our finger on and we can't encompass it with our minds. We can't define it. That is the image of God in each one of us. And then, oh my goodness, what Minerva was talking about, and we were talking about the halos around the saints. When a person becomes born again, all of a sudden the Spirit of God breathes life into him once again, and now you really are the image of God. So I hope that answers your questions, and let's move quickly. We've got folks waiting. Good afternoon. Welcome to Prayer and Answers. Is this Mark?
Yes.
Mark, go ahead. What's on your mind today?
I am volunteering.
Oh, praise God.
Prayer for your prayer request.
Good. I'm in a ton of pain, Mark. My back is just killing me. And so I'm asking, would you pray for some relief as I'm sitting in this chair taking the phone calls?
Yes, I will pray. Master in heaven, please forgive us our trespasses. And as the Roman soldier said to you, Lord, I'm not dignified for you to enter under my roof, but just say the word, and our servant, Randy, will be healed. And I am confident our Master in heaven is looking at you and saying, your faith has healed you. So I pray that when we look back at this hour on Saturday, December 9th at 2:16 in the afternoon, we will remember that was the hour that Randy's pain stopped in his back. Please calm, comfort, heal, restore, and renew Randy of this debilitating pain, Lord, so that he can serve you the way you want him to. And we pray for this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Mark. I really appreciate it.
You got it. And we also know that Steve is listening in. Steve, I had a hernia 8 years ago, man. I know what you're up against.
Yeah.
I'm sorry that it just doesn't want to stay in, but we're praying to God now, Lord, please heal Steve this time so he also can serve you the way you want him to. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Mark, very much. God bless you.
Okay, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye. Good afternoon, Virginia, and welcome to Prayer and Answers.
Good afternoon to you as well.
What's on your mind today?
Well, two things. The one thing is, I wonder how many Jewish people are sitting around angry and disappointed with the Lord, because once again, there was so much brutality aimed against them, and they are probably wondering where was the Lord when all of this was happening, like, you know, when 6 million of them died. I know some of them cast uncertainty and said so. So where was he when so many died? And I remember one pastor saying, well, he was right there.
Virginia, that is a profound question that you have. And it is filled with truth, and you've done very, very well. I'm going to give you a few statistics, and I'll answer a little bit, and then I'm going to turn it over to Hector and let him answer some more. But you've said it exactly right. Let me give you some statistics, first of all, from 2021. Of the Israeli Jews over the age of 20, about 45% identified as secular or not religious. Now, I want you to think about that. Now, 45% of the people who God called as a nation and revealed himself, you know, as the one true God, 45% are secular, meaning it's not just a matter of they don't believe in God, they don't care. They are totally secular. Now, of them, 33%, so I've got 45% are secular, 33% said they practice traditional religion religious worship. They practiced traditional. In other words, I remember the great Jewish scholar that says, being a Jew is not one of religion. Being a Jew is one of culture and tradition. And that's where Judaism is going. And then only 10% are ultra-Orthodox Jews, and that would be kind of similar to like the Mennonites in our nation, as a people who are pulling back from the world and living in an ultra-Orthodox. 10% are living by the law. Now, what percent of them, of Israel, is Christian, meaning having a saving relationship with the Messiah that their God sent? Somewhere between 1% and 3%. We don't know for sure. And if you were to look and say, why is it that the Jewish nation has become so secular, the number one reason that they will give, particularly the older ones, is because of the Holocaust. Where was God? And it's not only the Holocaust. Why were they kicked out of Spain? I mean, throughout all of history, the Jewish people have been persecuted. Did you ever see the movie or the musical Fiddler on the Roof? Did you ever see that?
Parts of it here and there. I don't remember about it.
One of the things the hero says, who's a Jewish guy, is he goes, God, if we're your chosen people, could you choose somebody else for a while? Because they were constantly being persecuted. And so when I look at Jewish people and think, you know, If I knew my people had gone through the Holocaust, would I believe in God? Would I be wondering where he was? And of course, the answer to this is he was there to any who would have turned to him. He was there. And that God doesn't promise to keep us out of persecution, but he promises to walk through it with us if we will turn to him. But they ended up turning away instead of turning to. And many of them were secular even before the Holocaust. It's a very unique situation when you talk about the nation of Israel in world history. Okay? But it breaks my heart for them. And so I'm praying that they'll meet Jesus. All right? Hector, what are your thoughts on this?
Hi, Virginia. How are you?
Okay, and you?
I'm good. Well, thank you so much for calling in, and thank you so much for your question. That is a very profound and difficult question. When I think about this, my heart goes back to Genesis 1 in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve rejected God, and when they came under disobedience rather than obedience and heard the serpent's voice at that time. The relationship with God was severed. It was broken. And we know through biblical history, through prophecies, that only Jesus was the one to restore that relationship. And so if we were to come under a covenant relationship with Jesus, he would restore the relationship that was broken with God. The Hebrew people, the Jews, will always be God's chosen people and God's covenant people. God has always had his hand on them. As a matter of fact, I believe the Bible says that they are the apple of God's eye. Yes, ma'am. But in the New Testament, unfortunately, they rejected Jesus as God's only son. They crucified him. Now, of course, this was all for the purpose of our salvation. It was written in prophecy, but it's still written in the word that the Jews turned their back on Jesus, and they did not accept Jesus as their Messiah. As a matter of fact, I believe that that they're still waiting for their Messiah and for their Savior. when we turn our backs on God, that creates a vacuum where the world and Satan comes in. And so it's an unfortunately, the reality is that we do live in a broken world. We do live in a world that is infected with sin. It is a very sad thing that the Holocaust happened, and it's heartbreaking. These are some profound questions that we still are looking for the answers, but I can tell you that God is still love. God is still sovereign. God is still on his throne, but sin is still in the world. God still loves his people, and he will always love his people. Now, why did he not intervene and protect them? I don't really know, but I do know as individuals that God is love and God is still merciful, and that if we surrender to him as individuals, he will come into our lives and change us inwardly and our circumstances as well.
Virginia, I'm going to read a Bible verse to you, something for you to reflect upon, okay, in regards to your question. First thing I want to ask you is this. Who was the first Jewish person? Who's the father of the Hebrew nation? Who's the father of the Hebrew nation?
The Lord?
No, the first one that God called and brought him and made the covenants with him. Remember, it was Abraham. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Abraham is the father. In fact, the Hebrew, I mean, he's the first Hebrew. He's the first one to cross over the river to follow God. He's the first one that God chose and said, I'll make a nation out of you. Here's what Jesus said about Abraham. I love this. In John chapter 8, because my heart breaks for the Jewish people. Here's what he says in John chapter 8 about Abraham, verse 56. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. Now that's what Jesus says about Abraham. He rejoiced to see my day. He saw it and was glad. And Virginia, where my heart is on that is, if the Jewish people could see Jesus, their Messiah, if they could actually see him, they would be glad that the only hope for them is to come to see the one that they've pierced and trust in him and believe in him. And then they, too, can finally, finally have the peace they're looking for. Okay?
Okay.
I'm out of time, but I thank you so much for calling in, Virginia. And I want to thank all of our callers and for calling in. And I pray that you will have a blessed Sunday tomorrow and that you'll go to church and be with God's people. Until next week, if the Lord tarries and if he is willing, when we will be here again, until next week, may God richly bless you.
Thank you for listening to Prayer and Answers presented each Saturday afternoon at 1:30. Tune in again next week at this same time for Prayer and Answers. Jesus is the way.